Okay, good evening. We're going to go ahead and get started tonight. Hope everyone enjoyed your meal. Again, I'd like to thank you all for being here and being a part of the August High School Conference at the Reagan Ranch. I had the pleasure of introducing Dr. Paul Kengor this afternoon, and I know the students really enjoyed his remarks about the history of the left's efforts to dismantle traditional marriage and family. I know that was really interesting for all of us. Dr. Kengor is a beloved professor of political science at Grove City College in Grove City, Pennsylvania, and the executive director of the college's Center for Vision and Values. I actually had the pleasure of having Dr. Kengor as a professor when I was a student at Grove City, so hearing him speak today actually brought back some great memories. Dr. Kengor is an internationally recognized authority on Ronald Reagan, the Cold War, communism, and conservatism, and he has been quoted or featured in almost every major U.S. news publication and even some international publications. He is a New York Times best-selling author of over a dozen books. My two personal favorites are 11 Principles of a Reagan Conservative, which is actually based off a speech given to a YAF audience, and then God and Ronald Reagan, but I would recommend that you all read all of his books. He's been a major part of Young America's Foundation's Reagan Ranch project from its inception. He has spoken to our students at our national headquarters in Reston, Virginia, and at our summer conferences in Washington, D.C., as well as countless times here at the Reagan Ranch Center. If you've all had the chance to tour the galleries upstairs, you've already had the chance to read some of Dr. Kengor's work, as he contributed to a lot of the copy in the exhibits. Thank you, Dr. Kengor, for all you do for Young America's Foundation. Dr. Kengor's most recent book, A Pope and a President, is a fascinating look at the bond that developed between Pope John Paul II and Ronald Reagan as they worked together to bring the end of the Cold War. So ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Paul Kengor.
Thanks, Ashley. It was too nice. Don't believe anything she said about me. But appreciate it very much. And Ron, Andrew, everybody, so good to be back here. It's one of my favorite organizations. I absolutely love Young America's Foundation. You guys are doing some of the best work out there of any group in the country. And especially with, I talked earlier about how the universities are in such a mess. And yeah, that's why you need YAF even more. And it just seems to get worse and worse, doesn't it? It really does. So, but I talked about that earlier, and I know that was depressing, wasn't it? And you know, so what somebody said, what was the lesson in all of that? I said, well, we're going to hell in a handbasket, right? And that's, I didn't want to leave you with that impression. So. I, in case you were ready to jump off the roof of the building after lunch, I assure you that this talk is going to be much more uplifting. So this will be a corrective, hopefully to what you heard at lunch. This is a good story. This is a great story, I think, with a happy ending. And we don't get enough of those nowadays. And in history, we don't get enough of these. So I'll just start right in. This is, it's a 648-page book. I turned in a 333,000-word manuscript. You guys don't ever complain about a term paper that has to be like 3,000 words, all right? So about 333,000 words that I turned in. And part of the problem is I didn't know where to start the story. I didn't know where to end it. And just telling the story of the persecution of the religious by the communists, where do you start? Where do you end? You can go on and on and on and on with that. That was probably the hardest part. I started filing FOIA requests, Freedom of Information Act requests for this book back in the year 2000. So it's the kind of thing that it's just hard to know where to stop writing. And so to give a talk on that, which would, you know, take me probably, I could probably stand up here for 3 weeks and read the book. It would take me that long to get through it. So how do I condense all of that into less than an hour? started in May 13th, 1917. I actually started the book with May 13th, 1981, and then dropped back to May 13th, 1917. And they talk about Ronald Reagan and Carol Wojtyla growing up in their respective hometowns, their mothers. All the parallels in their lives are fascinating. Ronald Reagan, Carol Wojtyla's mother died when he was 8 years old. And Ronald Reagan's mother almost died when she was 8 years old. And had she died, I don't think Ronald Reagan would become president. I mean, she was that formative to everything that he did. They were raised, Carol was raised by a loving father, and his father died just a few weeks, about the same time, February, May 1941, that Jack Reagan died, Ronald Reagan's dad, and Carol Wojtyla's father died. So he grew up, Carol Wojtyla grew up in Poland during World War II. So where do I start this, right? Well, we'll start it at October 16th, 1978. Jump a little bit ahead, which I know vast majority of people in this room weren't born yet, right? But October 16th, 1978. So after about a 60-year war on religion, and we talked about this earlier, right? What Marx called the opiate of the masses, Vladimir Lenin called the abominable necrophilia of religion. All worship of a divinity is a necrophilia, Lenin said. So after this going on for about 60 years, the conclave, the College of Cardinals, met at the Sistine Chapel in Rome. The previous pope had been pope for 33 days. That was it. And he took the name John Paul. By the way, when they asked him what he was going to call himself, he said John Paul I. I said, well, how could you be a John Paul I? There hasn't been a John Paul II yet. And he said, he will come soon enough. And he gestured to the person that was sitting in front of him, the cardinal from Poland, who got some. It was as if he knew. 33 days, and that was it. So they got back together, and they elected the first non-Italian pope in 455 years. So think about how long that is, you guys, right? I mean, that's like twice the length of the life of America. For 455 years, there had been nothing but Italian popes. I mean, the pope was Italian, period. There had never been a Slavic pope, and never one from Poland. So right smack in the middle of this communist war on religion, the most important country in the entire communist bloc, Poland, the only one that still retained the religious faith. About 90% of Poles were practicing devout Roman Catholics. And here, of all places, the conclave gets together and they picked a Polish pope, a Polish pope. So Carol Wojtyla, 264th heir to the chair of St. Peter, right? From Peter all the way to him, 264 popes. The reaction to this, Poles were ecstatic. They couldn't believe it. They said, this can't be true. This can't be true. I mean, you couldn't check the internet in those days, and the only media that they had was communist-controlled media. Communist-controlled media, they turned on basically their version of the evening news, which is one channel, controlled by the government. That was it. Christoph Meissner, who's a Polish physicist, recalled it this way. We waited and waited and waited, turned on the evening news. Alas, an announcer came on with a very, very sad face and said a new pope had been elected, and it was Carol Wojtyla, Cardinal Wojtyla. That was it, nothing else. Then he quickly switched to the harvest figures, the potato crop, as if nothing had happened, right? Ho-hum. Meanwhile, they're completely panicked. The communists are. What are they going to do about this? Moscow's public reaction, the only reaction I could find in the Soviet media archives, three sentences, published in Pravda, which was the official Soviet publication, TASS, which was the Soviet Communist Government news agency. It's all they said. The election of the new head of the Roman Catholic Church was announced here. He is a Polish cardinal, Archbishop of Krakow, Karol Wojtyla. He took the name John Paul II. That's all they said. Meanwhile, they had this guy's apartment bugged, all right, in Poland for decades. All right, believe me, they knew who this guy was. The private reaction, we now know Yuri Andropov, the longest-running head of the KGB in the Soviet Union. We'll get back to him later. He called the KGB chief in Warsaw. We now have the transcript of this conversation. And he said, how could you possibly allow the election of a cardinal from a socialist country as pope? And the KGB chief in Warsaw said, I think you need to direct your question to officials in Rome rather than here in Warsaw. And Andropov didn't laugh. He wasn't one to laugh, right? He snarled, growled. Karol Wojtyla was just as shocked as everyone else. He turned to Father Stanislav Zhivich, his close aide, who's still alive, and he said the Italian phrase, Liposino, what have they done? Do they realize what they've done here? I mean, are they crazy? A Polish pope. Cold War's going on, right? Right now. Moscow wondered the same, right? What have they done? The Pope's first homily, October 22nd, 1978, 6 days later, Sunday homily. These great words that are more prominent in the New Testament, I'm told, than any other three words. Be not afraid. Be not afraid. Jesus said that to the disciples at the Transfiguration. The angel Gabriel said it to Mary at the Annunciation. Be not afraid. Be not afraid. Be not afraid. Open the doors to Christ. Open them wide. Open the borders of states, economic and political systems, the vast domains of culture. That was something that you weren't supposed to say at the time. But Moscow, very afraid, very worried. The head of the Soviet Union, sorry about that, Ashley. Sorry about that, girls. Head of the Soviet Union was Leonid Brezhnev. And the new pope announced that he was, for his first foreign visit, he was going to Poland, of all things. And this is what I love. This is a great, Reagan and John Paul II are a story of leadership, all right? Who guys who aren't afraid to offend people. And when the communists said, you can't go to Poland. So why not? It's my native country. Well, no pope has been to a communist country. Do you know what that would do if the pope went to Poland? I'm going to Poland. Period. I'm going to Poland. Brezhnev called the head of the Communist Party in Poland. This is an actual transcript. And he told him, Edward Gierek said to Brezhnev, how could I not receive a Polish pope when the majority of my countrymen are Catholics? This isn't the actual phone call right here, but we found a picture of Brezhnev with a phone there, and it was shirt off, and I had to put it on there. You got to make fun of, if you can't make fun of a communist dictator, who can you make fun of? So, but Brezhnev told Gierek to tell the Pope to make up an excuse. Say that he's not feeling well. He's feeling sick, right? That he can't make the trip. As if that's going to be his excuse for the next 26 years, right? I'm still not feeling well. Can't go to Poland. Yeah, still can't come. Not feeling well. All right. So, but Gierek said, I got to let him come. And Brezhnev slammed down the telephone and said, Gomulka was a better communist than you. 9 days in Poland, June 2nd to 11th, 1979. Massive crowds. Look at the size of that crowd, all those people. Can you imagine like a Catholic mass where they're serving communion to a million people, getting in line, one after another, walking up through? Huge crowds. Lech Walesa, the head of the Solidarity Movement in Poland, which was just starting at that point, hadn't even been legalized yet. And he said, the new pope comes to Poland, and the 20 who followed me were suddenly 1 million, right? 10 million, suddenly 10 million. A greater multiplication, he said, than the loaves and the fishes. So for his first mass, and this is poetic, and again, this is leadership. Symbolic. He said, I'm going to hold the first mass at Victory Square in Warsaw. Victory Square. And he said there, Christ cannot be kept out of the history of man in any part of the globe. The exclusion of Christ from the history of man is an act against man. Without Christ, it is impossible to understand the history of Poland. No question about that. Absolutely true. And then this phrase, there can be no just Europe without the independence of Poland marked on its map, which was exactly what the communists said he cannot do. If he comes here, no mischief. He can't be doing any calling for independence, nothing like that. He stands up there at Victory Square, first homily. There can be no just Europe without the independence of Poland on its map, which really just infuriated the Kremlin. So, Kremlin decides, you know, what are we going to do about this? Before we get to that, the reaction to this in real time, June 5th, 1979, the New York Times. I like to make fun of the New York Times any chance I can get. So this is one of those occasions. But they wrote this editorial. Look at how snooty and arrogant this is. As much as the visit of John Paul II to Poland, you know, might reinvigorate, maybe re-inspire the Catholic Church in Poland, it does not threaten the political order of the nation or of Eastern Europe. Yeah, right. Right. Tell that to Moscow. Tell that to the Soviets. Ronald Reagan's reaction. Here's where I want to bring Reagan into the story. Ronald Reagan was here in California. He hadn't had the 1980 presidential campaign yet, obviously. He had run for president in 1976, former governor of California at that point. Richard V. Allen, Dick Allen, was sitting in his living room with him. They'd been talking foreign policy all day. They went in to turn on the 6 o'clock evening news, and they saw these massive crowds for the Pope, wherever he came out in Poland. And Allen said tears were in Reagan's eyes. And he said, that's it, that's it, that's it. The Pope is the key, the Pope is the key, the Pope is the key. He said, we got to reach out to the Vatican and the new Pope and make them an ally. And Reagan at that point had told Dick Allen earlier, he said, Dick, my idea of foreign policy toward the Soviet Union is simple. It's this, we win and they lose. So how's he going to figure out how to win? Right here, this new Polish Pope. Which the New York Times is like, no big deal, right? No big deal. Reagan knew. He understood then and there just how powerful this was. This was a game changer, a historical game changer. Ronald Reagan had a nationally syndicated radio broadcast at the time. He handwrote these, all of them. They're about 500 words each. They were about 3 to 4 minutes each. They were carried daily all across the country, thousands of radio stations. He went straight into the studio and he did a whole bunch of talks, a whole bunch of radio broadcasts just on the Pope's visit to Poland. He said, Stalin once contemptuously asked, how many divisions does the Pope have, right? Right, how many divisions does the Pope have? Reagan said, well, now we got the answer. Wherever he went in Poland, huge crowds, 400,000, 500,000, 1 million, 5 million people, 30 million people in all of Poland. You imagine a crowd of 5 million going to a mass to greet this Pope? Reagan said, Poles lived first under the Nazis and then the Soviets. The voices behind those tanks and guns have told them there is no God. Will the Kremlin ever be the same again? He knew. Will any of us, for that matter? And Reagan was never the same again. Something had changed. He said, this is big. Bill Clark, who's one of the original founding trustees of this ranch, right? Bill's pictures are all over the place, right, Andrew? I'm looking over there to see if I can see it. But he said that Ronald Reagan understood that Poland would be the linchpin in the dissolution of the Soviet Empire. So if you could picture Poland, picture the communist bloc, BLOC, like a block of wood, BLOCK. If you could pound a wedge into Poland, you could split the entire communist bloc from top to bottom. But how do you do that? 1977, no one really knows. Early 78, no one really knows. And then they pick a Polish Pope. That's how you do it. That's the key. But as Reagan told Allen, we got to win the presidency. Right? We got to win the presidency. That's not easy, right? Not easy to win the presidency. And all the new Pope had to do? Survive. This document was recently found by John Kohler, a Cold War scholar and a journalist, UPI correspondent. Around 2005, he broke this. We now know November 13th, 1979, in Moscow, the Soviet Central Committee got together. Nine of these old men that all look just like Brezhnev, with the exception of a young whippersnapper in the group named Mikhail Gorbachev, was part of this. And they decided, what are we going to do about this menace, this Polish Pope? They resolved, quote, use all possibilities available to the Soviet Union, which is a scary prospect for a country that's responsible for murdering tens of millions of people. When they say use all possibilities available, to prevent the new course of policies initiated by the Polish Pope, if necessary, with additional measures beyond disinformation and discreditation. Now, Kohler got this document from CISDA, the Italian Secret Service Agency. And as he said, in layman's terms, this was an order for assassination. Foreshadowed by the need to, quote, get physically close with the Pope. It wasn't to dance with him, all right? Kohler also said at the end of the document was this note from Italy's Secret Service, CISDA. CISDA says document found in Moscow points to plan for the, quote, physical elimination of JP2, unquote. I've had a bunch of people, and I've done a bunch of interviews on this book, and I've had a number of like younger talk show hosts say, really? They'd kill a pope? The Soviets would kill a pope? I'm like, yeah, they'd kill a pope. Absolutely. And Ronald Reagan never put that. Ronald said, oh, yeah, they would kill a pope. Absolutely. I mean, these guys, if they could have gotten, if Stalin could have rode a tank into the middle of St. Peter's Square, I mean, he would have lynched Pius XII from the rafters of the Basilica, man. He would have fitted the noose himself. Could have gotten close enough. All Reagan had to do was win. Here you go. All right. You can applaud if you want. The Reagan Ranch here, November 4th, 1980. Didn't look like that in the last election, right, you guys? No? Which it was called for Trump about 3 or 4 in the morning. They called this one early. 44 out of 50 states beat an incumbent president 51 to 41%. Electoral college count 489 to 49. Isn't that amazing? You know how many states he won in 1984 in his re-election? 49. Twice won California. When is that going to happen again with a conservative Republican? Twice won Massachusetts. Twice won New York. Twice won my home state of Pennsylvania. Amazing, really. The Electoral College count in 1984 was 525 to 13. Just stunning. Reagan was inaugurated January 20th, 1981, pledged an era of national renewal. He was sworn in by Chief Justice Warren Burger. They used his mother Nell's Bible, which is on display now at the Reagan Library. That's it right there. And his mother, very religious, Disciples of Christ denomination. And this stuff is noted in your chapel upstairs here. He had it open to 2 Chronicles 7:14 in the Old Testament, which is the verse that says, if my people turn from their wicked ways, I will heal their land. And right next to that, that's where his hand is sitting, right on that verse. And right next to that, Nell had written an annotation, his mother, right next to it. It said, a wonderful verse for the healing of a nation. And that's what Reagan was pledging himself to doing, to that and winning the Cold War. Moscow immediately feared an alliance between Reagan and the new pope. And you wouldn't know this unless, you know, you read Pravda and Izvestia and Soviet publications in February, March 1981. And who did that? You know, some research analyst at the CIA, State Department, that was about it. But I've read the media archives, and it's amazing. They were terrified in the Soviet Union. They referred to, the Soviet press referred to John Paul II as a, quote, malicious, lowly, perfidious, and backward toady. That's kind of typical language for the communist world. It really was. I mean, it's unbelievable the language they use. It's just so over the top. You're almost laughing as you're like, seriously? A perfidious, lowly, malicious toady? The Pope? Seeking to undermine communism with his overseas accomplices and his new boss in the White House. John Paul II's new boss in the White House, Reagan, his new boss. He's going to take his orders from Reagan. If only one of these two men could be gone, and here I quote Uncle Joe, death solves all problems. No man, no problem. March 30th, 1981. Almost got one of their wishes, right? John Hinckley, Ronald Reagan is leaving a audience after speaking to the AFL-CIO, 2 o'clock, Washington Hilton. John Hinckley is in a hotel across the street. Got the Washington Star newspaper that day, and in those days they printed the president's schedule. He's not working for any international conspiracy. He's just trying to get the attention of an actress, Jodie Foster. That's all he was trying to do. He was just trying to get Jodie Foster's attention. And boy, he would get it, right? So he's looking for somebody big to assassinate. And he looks in the Washington Star and says, Reagan's going to be right there today at 2 o'clock. So he goes outside. He's got a .22 pistol. He's using these .22 Devastator bullets, which explode on impact, cause big internal damage. Fires several shots. Jim Brady, the press secretary, hits the ground, bleeding out of his head immediately. Kevin McCarthy, Secret Service agent, turns himself into a human shield. Jump between the shooter and the President of the United States. Jerry Parr, one of the Secret Service agents, throws Reagan into the back of the limousine. Reagan had waved like this to the crowd, to the press, and one of the bullets went in underneath his armpit. Parr shoved him into the back of the car, and Reagan said, Jerry, get off. I think you've broken one of my ribs. And Parr propped him up and looked, and there were frothy blood bubbles coming out of Reagan's mouth. He said, you've been hit. That's a lung wound. And he immediately ordered the driver to go straight to George Washington University Hospital. And they said later, if he wouldn't have made that snap decision, Reagan could have bled to death in the back of the car. This is amazing, too, because at the time, there were reports that Reagan hadn't even been hit. Right? But he was bleeding to death, bad. He gets to George Washington University Hospital, and he tells the surgical team, I hope you're all Republicans, before he went out. And this is an amazing statement. He wrote this in his diary and also in his memoirs, An American Life. Right before he went out, I focused on that tiled ceiling, and I prayed because I realized I couldn't ask for God's help while I felt hatred for the mixed-up young man who had tried to kill me. I said, isn't that the meaning of the lost sheep? We're all God's children. Amazing, amazing statement. His pastor at the time, Reverend Louis Evans of the National Presbyterian Church in Washington, called me. I first reported on this in a book I wrote in 2004 called God and Ronald Reagan. I didn't interview Evans, and Evans read that book, and he called me and said, I got to tell you some stuff. And one of the things he told me, he visited Reagan after this, of course, he was his pastor at the time, and he said, Ronald Reagan told me he had this powerful sense that if he didn't forgive his shooter on the spot, God was going to take him. Like his survival was conditional upon him forgiving his shooter, which is exactly what he learned from his mother. I mean, he could hear his mother's voice, right? Ronnie, you need to forgive. Ronnie, you need to forgive. All right. Reagan survived, told his son Michael, daughter Maureen, Billy Graham, Reverend Louis Evans, Cardinal Cook, Mother Teresa, a bunch of others, that he had been spared by God for a special purpose, which he believed now was to take on, once and for all, atheistic Soviet communism. 6 weeks later, May 13th, 1981, right? Death solves all problems. No man, no problem. St. Peter's Square, 23-year-old Muslim Turk named Mehmet Ali Asha, working for the Bulgarians and the Soviets. We now know this. I spend more time on the book on this than on anything else. This is why I knew I really had to write the book, was laying all of this out. He's going to name 7 accomplices. He's waiting there all day, dropped off at like 9 a.m., wait till 10 a.m., 11, 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 o'clock. On the other, he's concealing a 9mm semi-automatic Browning in his jacket. On the other side of St. Peter's Square, one of his accomplices, Oral Chelik, has a panic bomb. And so as soon as Asha starts to shoot, Chelik on the other side of the square is going to ignite this panic bomb to cause a big explosion and noise and ruckus on the other side. That way Asha can run away after he shoots. They wait hours. Finally, the Pope, the white Fiat Pope Mobile, pulls up about quarter past the hour, 5:13 p.m., George Weigel says, which means it matched the exact time on the calendar, 5:13:81, May 13, 1981, 5:13 p.m. Passes the ancient obelisk in the middle of St. Peter's Square. How many of you have been there? Any of you been to St. Peter's Square? The obelisk, that's where Peter was actually martyred, killed. Drives past that. Asha sees him. He gets about 20 yards away, lifts his pistol in the air, squeezes it, fires 4 times. 2 shots hit the Pope, 1 in the hand, 1 in the abdomen. And you see him falling there into the arms of Father Zhivich, his closest aide. Zhivich asked, are you hit? Where? In the stomach. Does it hurt? Yes. Reagan had written in his diary, getting shot hurts, he wrote in his diary. Reagan did, typical Reagan. Said it was incredibly painful. Getting shot hurts. The Pope is rushed to Gemelli Hospital. Traffic is almost impassable. Impassable. And Zhivich said, one more traffic obstruction along the way, one mistake here or there, he would have bled to death in the car. Just like Ronald Reagan. Losing a whole bunch of blood, barely conscious when he gets to the hospital, and his last words to the nurse before he went out were, how could they do it? How could they do it? An amazing statement, because there was only one shooter. He could probably see, right, where the direction is coming from. And, you know, Reagan knew it was a mixed-up young man right away, but he immediately senses this is plural. This isn't a singular act, incident. The parallels, he got there, Francesco Crescitti, the best surgeon in the hospital, just happens to get there right on time. Ronald Reagan is brought to GW University Hospital. There happens to be the monthly meeting of all the department heads. The very best are there. Crescitti said he walked in, he said, normally every elevator, you gotta wait and wait and wait. He said he walked in and every single elevator, all the doors were open. He said some unknown genius, as he put it, had opened all the doors to all the elevators. Went straight up to the ninth floor, walked in, they scrubbed him, and he looked grimly at his patient whose blood pressure had dropped to 70. Father Zhivich anointed him with last rites. They tried to give him a transfusion. He rejected the original transfusion. The doctors on the spot in the room opened up their sleeves and donated their blood. He would undergo 5.5 hours of surgery. He required 6 pints of blood transfused. It's a lot of blood. Reagan needed 8. The bullet missed his main abdominal artery by centimeters. It missed Reagan's main aortal artery by his heart by centimeters. So centimeters either way, either direction, and they're done. It's over. And I can tell you right now, I mean, if Reagan dies March 30th, 1981, and this guy dies May 13th, 1981, that chunk of the Berlin Wall is not sitting out there, right? There's no way. Everything would have changed. Everything. Maybe communism would be collapsing now, but it wouldn't have in November 1989. They would have been standing on that Berlin Wall in November 1989. Asha tried to escape, but he was seized by a nun. A nun named Sister Letizia from the Bergamo region of Italy. And that's not her, but I love the picture, and it kind of looks like how I imagine her. So, I mean, that's just, any of you went to Catholic school and had the nuns, right? Right, Father Tom, that's her, right? You had one of those, taught you math, right? You had her? Yeah, that's her. So, but she grabbed him and pinned him down and said, why did you do it? He said, I didn't do it. She's terrifying him, right? She said, yes, you. No, not me. Yes, you. So she pinned him down. Somebody else helped out. And little did he know, she was saving his life. Because the plan was that he would get back into the household goods delivery truck. It was being concealed as a household goods delivery truck, and then they'd whisk him away. But they weren't going to do that. These were the communists. These were the Soviets. These were the greatest liars and murderers of all time. They're not going to give this guy a suitcase of cash and $300,000 and send him off to the Caribbean, right? You know, you didn't think we were going to let you get away with this, comrade, right? I mean, the plan was to murder him. Somebody said after one of my recent talks, yeah, just like the mafia. And I said, don't insult the mafia by comparing them to the communists. That's not fair. It was the feast day of Our Lady of Fatima, May 13th, 1981. For any of you who are Catholic, you know this well. And this is a central part of the story. And for John Paul II, this was huge. And I think one of the most interesting things that I report in the book, Ronald Reagan was intensely interested in this and knew this as well. So it's central to the whole story. And you know, two of the shepherd children recently canonized by Pope Francis. But they had the first alleged appearance of Mary was May 13th, 1917 in this village in Fatima. And she allegedly made 3 predictions, one of which was the end of one world war and the start of another. which indeed happened. The other was the rise of communism in Bolshevik Russia, and that it would spread its errors around the world. The third of these was the third secret of Fatima, which almost everybody knows about, right? I mean, if you grew up this, everybody was wondering, what's the third secret of Fatima? What's the third secret of Fatima? Glenn Beck asked me about the third secret of Fatima, right? Everybody wanted to know what the third secret of Fatima was. And so John Paul II asked to read the third secret of Fatima. He had not read it yet. It had been read only by two or three previous popes. It was literally sealed in a vault, the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. And he started thinking, 2/13 of May, May 13th, 1917, our feast day of Our Lady of May 13th, 1981. So he asked to read the third secret. They brought it to him July 18th, 1981, while he was recovering in Gemelli Clinic. And he read it and saw that it predicted not the end of the world, not a nuclear apocalypse, which some people thought that it was, not the second coming of Jesus, but an attack on the Holy Father, the bishop in white. The only bishop that wears white is the Pope. And that he would be attacked, murdered, killed by gunfire. And he looked at that and he said, that's me. That applied to me. This, when he was finished, said Jivich, all his remaining doubts were gone. In that, he recognized his own destiny. So that's central to John Paul II. And Ronald Reagan was fascinated about it. Ronald Reagan gave a speech in Portugal, May 9th, 1985, where he talked about Mary, Fatima, the shrine, the three shepherd children, all of this. He even talked about John Paul II going to the shrine of Fatima, the one-year anniversary of the shooting, May 13th, 1982, and he took the bullet, was in his body, and put it in the crown of Our Lady of Fatima. Reagan knew about that. Reagan had a Catholic father. Reagan had a Catholic brother. Reagan knew about all of this stuff. He even talked about it in the speech in May 1985. And look at this statement. This is amazing. Reagan said, in the prayers of simple children of Fatima, there resides more power than in all the great armies and statesmen of the world. Again, how many divisions does the Pope have, right? Reagan believed in this power of prayer. So as I say, whether you believe in this or not, you have to take it seriously because they took it seriously, especially John Paul II. The White House reaction to the shooting of the Pope, Reagan's diary entry, was very, very, very brief for that day. Word brought to us of shooting of the Pope, called Cardinal Cook and Cardinal Kroll, sent message to Vatican and prayed. That was it. John Paul II had sent Reagan a letter, I'm praying for you, right after he was shot on March 30th, 1981. Reagan sent off a cable of just received the shocking news of the attack on you, our prayers are with you. These two now had formed the world's most exclusive mutual prayer society, basically. Dick Allen said, every day for weeks after this, Ronald Reagan would ask me about the condition of the Pope. Was very, very worried about this. The president's affection for the Pope was greatly magnified by the shooting. So the Soviets had been worried about an alliance between these two. Well, now they really better. I mean, this backfired big time, right? I mean, this couldn't have blown up in their face more. Reagan had a personal letter delivered to the Pope 5 days later by Congressman Peter Rodino. Took it directly to the Pope in Rome. And Reagan said this, happily few leaders in the world today have the dubious distinction of knowing with some precision exactly what you have gone through. They had a bond now. They didn't just hate communism. They didn't just agree on the value of the sanctity and dignity of human life, on the relationship between faith and freedom. Now they both had survived assassins' bullets. Now they both had very, very nearly died. 4 days after the Pope was shot, Reagan speaking in Notre Dame. Isn't that wild, of all things, right? America's premier Catholic college, and he's there giving the commencement speech that had already been set, that had already been planned. So Ronald Reagan would say, there's no coincidences, right? This had already surely, you know, this was in the cards. And he mentioned the shooting of John Paul II, and he mentioned John Paul II's previous year's encyclical, where he talked about certain economic theories that use the rhetoric of class struggle to justify injustice. The neighbor is sometimes destroyed, killed. I think for Reagan, this was his first public indication that he thought that the Soviets might have been behind the shooting. Bill Clark told me, when I first learned about this stuff from Bill Clark in July 2005, he said, oh yeah, Reagan and I and Bill Casey, we all suspected the Soviets from the very beginning. I said, did you tell anyone? He said, no, we couldn't say. We didn't know for sure, but we all suspected it from the very beginning. Bill Casey, CIA, head of the CIA, devout Irish Catholic. The morning after the shooting of the Pope, he called together a meeting of the National Foreign Intelligence Board in Washington to try to figure out what the Soviets were up to, if maybe they might have been involved in this. Moscow's reaction, only this, the next day from TASS. Again, after crowing and shooting their mouth off, suddenly they're tight-lipped again. According to a Vatican spokesman, Pope John Paul II remains in stable condition after undergoing 5 hours of surgery. The Pope was hit by 3 of the 4 bullets that the terrorists fired, which was inaccurate. He was only hit by 2. So Moscow was a little overly hopeful here, right? Maybe the plan was to get 3 out of 4. They needed to change the text after what had happened here. Wait, cross out 3, it was only 2. On May 15 came Pravda's first published response, where they kept referring to Asha as a Turk, a fascist. You could tell here, this was a red flag. They were doing everything they could. They didn't want anybody to think that they were involved in this. Not a chance. You can't read that, but that is a Soviet publication, obviously. The Guardian, the left-wing British publication, in September 1981, ran the first story suggesting that Moscow was behind the shooting. And then the Soviets went nuts. Called this a vile concoction. It never occurred to anyone to portray this piece of scum, Asha, as a communist agent. So this is absurd, groundless. In no time, the Soviets were blaming the shooting of the Pope on the CIA. Lie after lie after lie. You should try reading this stuff night after. It's depressing. Just the lies are amazing. All right, anyway, so these two finally met June 7th, 1982. They wanted to meet. They were in communication in February 1981, just a couple of weeks after Ronald Reagan was sworn in. Reagan wanted to meet with him back in June 1979, right? When the Pope first went to Poland. So they finally come together June 7th, 1982 at the Vatican. And Ronald Reagan, they met for one-on-one, 50 minutes, in the Vatican Library. Pope spoke 7 languages, including English. So they spoke in English, and Reagan said to him, look how the evil forces were put in our way and how Providence intervened. Bill Clark was there. Bill Clark said, it was a wonderful and transformative day. From then on, they forged a very personal relationship. Time magazine called it the Holy Alliance. A cardinal that was there at that first meeting, this is an amazing statement, think about this. Nobody believed the collapse of communism would happen this faster in this timetable, but in their first meeting together, the Holy Father and the President committed themselves and the institutions of the church in America to such a goal. And from that day, the focus was to bring it about. So they said, Poland is a key. If we can keep the solidarity movement alive in Poland, if we can force democracy in Poland, we could take down the whole house of cards. So imagine the non-Polish president, right? The non-Catholic president telling the Polish Pope, sir, hope remains in Poland. We, you and I, our teams working together can keep it alive. So that's where it started. They would go on to meet in total 5 times, one-on-one. Fairbanks, Alaska, May 1984. Miami, Florida, September 1987. The cover of the book is from the two of them meeting together in Miami. The Vatican, June 1987. Castel Gandolfo, September 1990. I'll talk about that one in a little bit. The relationship, they just greatly respected one another. Reagan, I have enormous respect and affection for him. Called him a truly great man. Nancy said the Pope was her favorite among all foreign leaders. right? They said that she's flipping through pictures with Joanne Drake, and she, you know, here's Ronnie with Margaret Thatcher, with Brian Mulroney, with Mikhail Gorbachev, and then they flipped. She goes, and it was Ronnie and the Pope. She said, my favorite. She actually met with him 7 times. Nancy Reagan did. They really liked him. They really respected him. They were in constant communication so many times. These are the redacted documents at the Reagan Library. See how that page is crossed out? It's still not declassified. To this day, these are the most classified documents at the Reagan Library. I filed the Freedom of Information Act request. They still haven't been fully declassified. The documents at the Vatican on the two of them meeting together are sealed for 75 years. So the transcript of that first meeting, June 7, 1982, we'll have those June 7th, 2057, 40 years. And a lot of you will be alive. So hopefully I'll be dead by then. So one of you pick this up, this project up. They had Martin and Annalise Anderson counted at least a dozen letters exchanged between them. By the end of 1981, a dozen letters. There was so much communication that Bill Clark and others feared there was too much communication going on between them, that they were overloading the Vatican circuits. Bill Clark said, no, we got to keep this going. We got to keep talking. Here, I'll go through some of these quicker. This one's one of my favorites. This is a late night February 1984 document, and it says the Pope has been trying to call the president all day. He can't get a hold of him. And so now, at almost midnight, Rome time, they're sending this document, and then it says on the second page, begin Pope's message to president, and then the whole page is blank. And then the next page, blank. Then it says, end of Pope's message to president. And what does it say? I mean, what was so important? What did he have to get to him? What's this about? I have no idea. I have no idea. The conduit, the main group that met was Bill Casey, Bill Clark, and P.O. Loggi, who flew all the way to the Reagan Ranch here to meet with Reagan on one occasion. Met with him at least 6 times through the gate of the White House. And you know, that was discreet, didn't want anyone to know that he was there. These three, Casey, Loggi, and Bill Clark, were meeting, as Clark put it, one way or another every week, having cappuccino at Cardinal Loggi's residence in Washington, finding out what's going on. Casey would fly to Rome in a windowless C-141 black jet, where he would share intelligence with the Pope. He would brief the Pope, show him satellite photos of missile silos, troop movements, anything he possibly could. And they all wanted to know what the Russians were up to. All right, which gets to the big scoop that I present in the book. I learned that Casey was so frustrated with the institutional CIA in Washington, doing terrible work, dragging its feet. There were guys of the CIA saying, no, the Soviets would never shoot a Pope. I mean, come on, that's really bad. It would never do that. Casey said, oh yeah, they would. So I was told, and I can't divulge my sources on this, and I go through it all very, very carefully in the book, probably 100 pages just on this, that Casey put together a team of 2 young women, one in her late 20s, early 30s, other like late 30s, early 40s, and they looked into this, and they presented their findings in a document that still hasn't been released yet. It's still classified. One of my sources says this was the most secretive document I've ever seen. He said we had to remove the eyeballs from the corpses of the corpses of the people who read it after they read it, jokingly, of course, right? But that document concluded that the Soviets ordered the hit on the Pope. And it was specifically organized by the Soviet GRU military intelligence with the order and go-ahead, the green light, of the head of the KGB, a guy named Yuri Andropov. Andropov gave the order. The briefing, when Casey briefed Reagan on this, I think it was May 16, 1985 that it happened. I got the documentation from the Reagan Library. I was told how the briefing went. Casey told him what he had. He was holding the document. Reagan said, can I see that?
He said, yeah, you can see it. Of course you can see it. You're the president. So he was saying, like, do I have security clearance to see that? He said, yeah, you can see it. And Reagan learned. Reagan learned then and there. By the way, Yuri Andropov, the head of the KGB, who was working at the KGB at the time? Vladimir Putin. But that said, there's no way Putin knew about this. He was too low level. He was a junior level official at that point. And I mean, this was the tightest thing the Soviets ever did. Super, super, super tight. I mean, it's not every day that you order a hit on the Pope. This was super tight. But that document, still classified to this day, still hasn't been released yet. John Paul II was briefed about it, the findings, by Casey. And I was told that John Paul II told Casey, keep it to yourselves. I don't want World War III over this. I don't want a big ruckus caused over this. And besides, he said, if I publicly blame them for this, they'll launch a disinformation campaign against me. They'll deny it. Probably would have the New York Times say, the Pope is really off of his rocker. What a strident anti-communist the Pope has become. Oh, Moscow. So he and then he said, too, he said, besides, everyone thinks they did it anyway. So let's just leave it at that. And that's where they left it. And to this day, I think the Vatican, I've talked to a number of people since the book has come out. And a couple sources really who have good knowledge of this kind of stuff said, it might not be that our CIA is not releasing this because they're afraid to offend the Russians. It could be that the CIA is not releasing it because the Vatican is still telling them not to release it. And that could be. But either way, the Russians did it. They ordered the crime of the century, as William Sapphire of the New York Times called it. All right, 1989, finishing up. So the collapse of communism would come that year. Ronald Reagan was visited at his, he left in January 1989, and he went back to Century City, California, his office there. I was told about this meeting. It's an amazing meeting. There were four Poles, three from Poland, one Polish-American, Chris Zawikowski told me about this. And Poland was preparing for the first free and fair elections in the communist bloc, which had been promised at Yalta in 1945. So they're finally about to happen. And so these Solidarity members who were in prison, one of them had carved Reagan a Madonna in prison and gave it to him. I mean, they considered Reagan their hero. And they asked him for some campaign advice. And Reagan, very kind of JP2-like, said to them, listen to your conscience, because that's where the Holy Spirit speaks to you. You're a little thrown off by that. And then he pointed to a picture of John Paul II, and he said, he's my best friend. He said, obviously, I'm Protestant, obviously, he's Catholic, but he's my best friend. Nancy Reagan used the phrase closest friend. I think what he meant by that, they weren't truly best friends. Like, they would call each other up to talk about the ball game or go fishing or go golfing. But I think what Reagan meant was that in this battle of the 20th century that started in 1917 and went to 1989, this battle against atheistic Soviet communism, he had no better, closer friend than John Paul II. I think that's what he meant. The elections were held in Poland June 4th, 1989. 100 seats. How many of the communists win? Zero. Zero. Which is why communists don't hold elections in North Korea. That's why they don't hold them in Cuba. All right? Another one of my favorite statistics. 100,000 Cubans have tried to swim to Florida. How many Americans have tried to swim to Cuba? Zero. Michael Moore and all these guys squawking about that wonderful free healthcare in Cuba. Well, then go. Nope, they won't go. 100 out of 100 seats. Mikhail Gorbachev said, when they held free and fair elections in Poland, I knew the Cold War was over. That was it. And it was a few months after that that the Berlin Wall fell. Poland was the key. Just like Reagan knew. By the way, the only thing Ronald Reagan and the Soviets ever agreed on, it's that Poland and the Pope were the key. Which is why Reagan said, I got to reach out to them and make them an ally. And which is why the Soviets said, we got to point a gun at him and put a bullet in his chest. And which is why the New York Times is wrong, as always. Vatican, September 1990. This was the last time that Ronald Reagan and John Paul II would meet. Reagan, at that point, was a private citizen. The only publication I could find that reported on it was USA Today, three sentences. That's it. They don't care about any of this kind of stuff. Former President Reagan and Nancy, they met with the Pope. Pope said, God bless America, after a 30-minute meeting. That's it. I asked Nancy Reagan about it. She said, it was a warm and wonderful meeting. Yes, we talked about the end of communism and all the historic things, but it was just a nice meeting among good friends who really respected one another. That, you know, that was it. If only they would have known it'd be their last time that they would ever meet. New century, 21st century. Ronald Reagan is fading, and so is John Paul II. Reagan from Alzheimer's. So the body is strong, but the mind is weak, right? John Paul II, Parkinson's. So with him, the mind is strong, but the body is weak. Bill Clark would die of Parkinson's. Bill Clark used to tell me, you know, Paul, the good Lord gave Parkinson's disease to saints like John Paul II and my father, and now he's gotten around to giving it to sinners like myself. That's what Clark said. That's typical Clark, is it not? So they're both failing, they're fading, and on June 4th, 2004, how's this for poetic? President George W. Bush flies to Rome to give the Pope the Presidential Medal of Freedom. He's hunched over, he can barely mouth words. Bill Clark called this the mask. Your face, Clark said, gets stuck with Parkinson's. You can't really speak well. And he mouthed a few words. He thanked Bush, he thanked Reagan. He said, I send my regards to President Reagan and to Mrs. Reagan, who he always said he was praying for. The very next day after that, Reagan died, June 5th. I'm always touched by Nancy stroking the casket, talking to the casket, you know, saying, it's okay, Ronnie, we're going home. We're going home soon. We're going home. The Pope immediately sent a telegram to Mrs. Reagan, saluting her husband, all that he had done. Less than a year later, April 2nd, 2005, John Paul II died. All right, last slide here. This is something you wouldn't read about in the New York Times. June 27, 2011, St. Mary's Basilica in Krakow, a special Thanksgiving Mass for Blessed John Paul II and for the life of Ronald Reagan on the centenary of Reagan's birth. Guess who was officiating? Cardinal Zivich, the priest who held a dying John Paul II in his arms on May 13, 1981 when he was shot. He's now officiating. And he said, this world is a battlefield of good and evil, truth and falsehood. That's what I was talking about this afternoon, right? Basically. Each of us faces a choice. Today we recall two great men who stood before this very choice, and their decision influenced the course of history and shaped the world in which we live. John Paul II and Ronald Reagan answered that call. They chose the side of good against evil. They fought on that battlefield. They didn't care that people called them names. They weren't afraid. They both took that admonition to heart, be not afraid. John Paul II took a bullet over it, a couple of bullets over it, but they survived and they went on to fight this battle of the century. And with that, these two men rewrote the story of the end of the 20th century. And if it wasn't for that and those guys surviving when they did, none of us would be here in this room right now. Think about that. All right, thank you very much. I'll take any questions. Wow, thank you. Thanks so much.
Okay, at this point, we are going to watch Still Point in a Turning World. It's a movie. Right. A movie produced by Steve Bannon, and this is meant to really get you fired up for your visit to the ranch tomorrow. So groups 1 through 3, you're going to look at the numbers on your name tag. Groups 1 through 3 are going to be in the theater, and groups 4 through 6 will be in the classroom, so you can make your way up. Follow Jolie. Thank you all. Yeah.